Hello everybody and welcome back to the second part of my character introduction series. I want to first start out by saying that if you haven't seen part one, I suggest you go and watch that. I'll leave the link to it in the description. It is kind of long, so it might be something that you want to find the time for. I'm hoping this video is a lot shorter. But yeah, I realize most people are probably stuck in their house during this quarantine anyway, so hopefully you have the time to go and watch that video and this. But yeah, like I said, this is the second part, so in this video I'll be covering one more character and sort of a different aspect that isn't technically new characters, but you'll see what I mean soon enough. My last video, of course, covered my main trio of characters, and this will sort of expand upon that and add a bit more. So unlike the last video where I ramble for a good half hour, I'm just going to jump straight into this with my first character here, Cosmoclore, and that is understandably a very difficult name to pronounce, so I often just call him Cosmo, since that's easier, and I thought that was a cool nickname for him. But yeah, so basically Cosmo is a sort of mentor figure to my main trio of characters. For one of... One sort of reason for that stands out above most, and I'll touch on that in a bit. But before that, basically he lives on the same planet as Roman, my insert character, and so basically he is axolotl humanoid. If you don't know what an axolotl is, I suggest you go look him up, they're really cute. But yeah, it's like a little amphibious creature. Basically, he's sort of that, and he lives in these beautiful, like, crystal caverns, or caves, or whatever you want to call them, on the planet of Nautica, which is where my character, Roman, lives. And so Roman was, like, already aware of Cosmoclore, and they were good friends for a long time. And, of course, upon Roman meeting Patrick and Amber, he obviously went ahead and introduced them to him. So, as you could probably already tell by just sort of his body language and his artwork there, he's a very, very chill and laid-back guy and the kind of person that gets along with almost everybody, and not only gets along with them, but tries to adapt to what they enjoy or what their personality is like to just sort of get along with them even better. All in all, he's just a very, very great person to be around. He's always happy. And not one of those people who are, like, fake happy all the time and put on a fake smile. He's a legitimately, like, jolly person, a great person to be around. I don't know how many other ways I can put that, but he's just a very good-hearted character. And I think that's a major reason why he fits in so well with my main trio of characters, because, in a way, they are all kind of like that as well in their own special way. But what I should move on to now, before I keep going on and rambling, is that he teaches them something very special, something that his get-along type of personality really reflects. So basically, his species is one of the few in the entire universe that have mastered the art of fusion. Fusion being the combination of two characters to make a whole larger than the sum of their parts. Just basically two characters coming together to form an entirely new person that still shares the attributes of the two characters, or more characters that make them up. And to clarify this even more, if you know Steven Universe and you know the fusions of Steven Universe, you know how Steven Universe fusions work, that's basically what this is. I'm not going to try to say that this is an original concept. I even follow Steven Universe rules where they get extra eyes and arms and all that sort of stuff. It's basically Steven Universe rules, if you know that, which, if you're a fan of this channel, I'm assuming you are also a fan of Steven Universe, and you can probably already tell that my style is deeply, deeply reflected in the Steven Universe style. But anyway, yeah, so Cosmo basically teaches my main trio of characters how to fuse. Roman has known about this prior, but of course upon Roman introducing Patrick and Amber to Cosmo, they figure it out as well, and obviously Roman, Patrick, and Amber go around the galaxy and sort of, you know, show this skill off as well once they get used to it, once they learn how it works, which leads to other characters that they meet learning how to fuse and fusing with them. And basically, I like to think of this concept of fusion in my story a lot more than just two characters combining together and they get a cool weapon or whatever. I think that it's very symbolic of the two characters' relationship, which is also something that's done in the Steven Universe very prominently. And that, I think that really reflects also the message I'm trying to get across, and in this story that I'm making, where it's very important to understand other people, understand where they're coming from, and do your best to get along with people. Enough rambling about that though. Basically, I don't want to sound all preachy, but what I'm saying is that, yeah, so fusion plays a larger part than just getting extra limbs or whatever. But I'll get into, the specificities of each fusion and why they're designed the way they are, and, sort of the meanings behind them once I, get to each individual fusion. So firstly, we start with Leo, and not only is Leo the first in this video, but I think the first fusion of any of my characters that I ever designed. He's gone through a lot of iterations, but I'm only showing really his up-to-date one in this video. So basically, he, as you already saw, he's the fusion of Roman and Patrick. And so I want to talk about his design first a little bit, and sort of what elements from each character plays into the design. Obviously, Roman is, I'll start with the very, face value sort of stuff. My character is very slender and thin, but then, obviously, Patrick is larger and bulky, and so I was like, okay, well, how do I, sort of combine this into a fusion, but, don't make it just even out into, a normal person? I want fusions to have, something special about them, look a bit more alien, look a bit less human, so I didn't want to just, a thin guy and a larger guy just balance out into an older person. So he's, if you look kind of, at Leo's design here, he's got a really big, upper chest, and then also really large legs, almost too large for the body, and then a thin waist. And so it kind of has this weird amalgamized, I don't even know if it's a word, but sort of unhuman physique, not to mention the extra eyes and arms too, which obviously come from, two different people fusing into one. But I think that's something very special about him, and one of my favorite elements about him is his weapon. So, if you were to look back, at my character's shield, and then also Patrick's sword, obviously they would combine into that axe that he has. So Patrick's sword becomes the hilt, and then the shield is the sort of blade of the axe itself. And then if you look at it even closely, you can see that the lava patterns on the axe itself is the same patterns on the sort of turtle shell. So about the lava though, I try to combine, the sort of elements of, each character as well. So Patrick is very fiery and he comes from a very hot place. So he's not made out of fire, but he has fiery aspects and sort of stuff like that. So I took that, and then also, Roman comes from a very nautical place, surrounded by a lot of water, he wears blue, and sort of stuff like that, and so obviously I was like, okay, well how do I combine that? I went through a few iterations, and I didn't really like it, so fire and water makes steam, or maybe, I didn't really know, because I gave him a gray color palette to reflect the steam in earlier designs, but I didn't like that as much. I just figured, okay, well, what could be a more liquid version of fire? And I know that sounds really stupid, but I was like, okay, lava would work, because that's, lava is very fluid but also very, very hot. So I was like, okay, well maybe that could work. So I have the strips of lava in the axe as well, and they're the center part of the axe is represent lava cooling and forming into obsidian, so lava going into the water or something like that and forming obsidian. And that's where I kind of got not only the design for the axe, but also in his color palette. And then also, if you see in the center of his artwork there, you can see that he, on occasion, can barf up lava as well, which is cause for some trouble sometimes, but they can get past it. And then if just a few other things. It says it on his character sheet there, but basically the center part of like his torso is like it's just, well, I guess not torso, but like his stomach area can rotate all the way around. And I thought that was just really cool for when he'd be like swinging his axe around, he could do like a 360. And I thought that'd just really cool for like some cool axe moves or whatever. But, and if you don't, like if you didn't notice already, that's obviously inspired by Sardonyx from Steven Universe, because she doesn't have an axe, she has a big hammer that she swings, and Sardonyx is one of my favorites, so I wanted to sort of take that element. But yeah, so about his personality a bit, he's very, very reckless. A lot of Roman's fusions, the other person's personality takes over, because Roman is very introverted, and he's not very outspoken, and he doesn't feel bad that other people are sort of like, you know, a bit more, you know, bombastic or overbearing than he is. He doesn't really care, because that's what he enjoys. He just doesn't really mind other people taking the spotlight. He doesn't like to be in the spotlight. So just a lot of his fusions, you know, his personality sort of takes a back seat, and it ends up being the other person sort of taking over. So Leo is very, very reckless, and almost more reckless than Patrick himself. So this fusion doesn't get brought out too often, because sometimes it causes more trouble than it's worth if they're in a sticky situation. But they have other fusions for that, which I'll touch on in a bit. But yeah, I think that's just about it for Leo. I could be forgetting something, but I'm rambling on enough. But yeah, so that's our first fusion done, Leo. Okay, I was forgetting something. So basically, right now I'm just going to go through sort of rapid fire some other artwork that I have of Leo. And because he's one of my earliest designs, I'm going to have the most artwork of him. In fact, I don't really have much other artwork of any other fusions besides him, really. So I'll just go through a few of these. Firstly, I want to show off this mermaid design that I did, and I explained this what mermaid was in the last video, but I'll just do a quick crash course of it right now. Basically, mermaid is basically every day of May, artists online basically draw a mermaid or merman every day of May, and so this past May, I went ahead and thought that was a good challenge to do. So Leo was one of them, and I did a bunch of them in my previous part of this series, if you want to go watch that. I did that for just the main trio that you saw in the last video. But yeah, I wanted to base his tail off of a marlin, because it had like some really cool fins, and then I could sort of warp the color palette just a tad bit to sort of match Leo's color palette. And I just felt like the sort of the jagged edges and the little stripes and stuff kind of fit Leo's aesthetic. I don't know. I guess it wasn't like one particular reason that I liked the design, but I thought a marlin or swordfish, I sort of combined those two. I thought it was a cool like look for his tail, and I just sort of stuck with it. Okay, so this next one is obviously very different from my style, and that's because I can't take full credit for it. I did draw the whole thing myself, nothing was traced, but I did take some, I guess, a reference from another artist that I found on, I believe it was Pinterest or Twitter, I forget, but it was an art of Nightwing, some fan art of Nightwing, and I just thought it was really, really cool looking, and he sort of had the same physique as Leo. I was like, I want to try to recreate that. I would totally mention the name of the artist, but it slips my mind. This was a while ago, but I will put like a link to their page, wherever it was, in the description as well, because I don't want them to go unnoticed, and this artwork is sort of like basically theirs as well, because I took some inspiration and reference from the pose and sort of shading, and I couldn't really done it without it. It's obviously very different from my style, and I couldn't do that on my own. Okay, so for this one, I used no reference, and it came out so nice. I'm so proud of this one, and this is even relatively like older, and I don't know what it is about it. I love the color palette. I feel like I nailed the pose. I'm normally not like this excited about my own artwork. I'm normally like hypercritical of it, but I don't know what it is about this. I just love the piece. I did it this past summer, and I just love the way it came out. Basically, if you haven't seen the previous video, the girl on the right is Amber. She's another one of my characters. But this is a good piece to show off, like, sort of the size comparison. And it's probably self-explanatory based on the picture you've seen, but obviously when the two characters fuse together, they not only get the extra limbs and eyes and stuff like that, but they also get relatively larger. So that's what you sort of see there. And then I also wanted to do this piece to sort of put both of them in different outfits too, because sometimes it can get kind of bland drawing them in the same outfit over and over again. And because it was summertime, I was like, I can draw them at the beach, and I gave them popsicles, and I don't know what it is, but I just love the way this piece came out. Alrighty, and now we're going to move on to our second fusion, who is Sky. And Sky is a fusion of Roman and Amber. Now, I'm going to be honest, I don't know how I feel about this fusion. It's one of my least favorites. I love all my characters, like my children, but I don't know what it is. There's something about the pose or the face. I don't know. I just feel like it's that thing that I felt like I wanted to avoid with Leo, with making them just, like, average. Because my character and, Amber have relatively average proportions, unlike a lot of my other characters. So I think Sky just suffers from being a little too average. Like, even Patrick has a red skin, which adds, like, a cool aspect to himself and the fusions. Whereas I think my character and Amber are, like, the only two characters I have with a regular skin tone. So I think it just makes for a relatively bland fusion, and it doesn't also, have a particular, like, aesthetic. Like, even with Leo, you can't really pin it down in one word, but Leo has, like, a wastelander sort of aesthetic that reflects Patrick's sort of background as well, whereas Sky is just, I don't know, I incorporated some browns in there, and browns and greens sort of reflects, like, a woodsy aspect, so I didn't want to. I can't keep sitting here and just ragging on Sky, because Sky's, they're okay. They're great. But they're not one of my absolute favorites. But what I was saying, though, was that woodsy aspect, I should probably run with that if I ever plan on redrawing Sky. Because I imagine the combination of Amber's healing and life-giving powers and Roman's, he doesn't have any water powers, but he's from a very nautical place. I mean, the planet's called Nautica that he's from, but he's, has a life very involved and surrounded by water. So I think the combination of Amber's light healing powers and the water, it could sort of reflect a nature aspect. And so one of Sky's powers is to grow plants. They can't do anything like nuts or anything, like they can't like grow huge trees or anything, but they can like induce the growth of plants and like heal the environment around them. They can heal people as well, like Amber, but the powers are dampened as this fusion because Roman obviously doesn't have this power. So it's kind of like basically just Amber's powers but dampened. So that's why I think that it's kind of a lackluster fusion for that reason, because it's not taking powers from either character, combining it to make something larger. It's just kind of subtracting from that. But, I mean, I don't know. I still like this fusion, and the weapon for Sky is something that I really struggled with, because I was like, I think a slingshot could be stupid, but that's the only thing I could think of that was like a good combination of a bow and a shield. But I think it came out alright. I'm not sure how I feel about the light ball, like, projectile thing that I have shown there, but it's good enough. I think Sky is a good enough fusion. I do think it needs some tweaking, because I imagine that this fusion would be showing up the most in comics out of the main three, because, this fusion is obviously the most stable out of the main three fusions, because they don't, this one doesn't include Patrick, and he's, very wild and reckless. But yeah, so I think this fusion could definitely use some tweaking, but I still like it, and I realize that it has a lot of potential. Alright, so our third fusion and the final fusion of the main trio, or I should say final two-character fusion of the main trio, is Blaze. Now, Blaze, just like Leo, is very, very reckless and dangerous. They are also bigger than Leo, so there's a lot more room for error there. And their weapon is also very dangerous. It's a crossbow that shoots flaming arrows. So Blaze is the big guns, basically. The fusion that comes out when they need a lot of damage done. I felt like their sort of aesthetic really reflected that. For example, their flaming hair. I thought that also kind of, goes back to what I was saying with Sky and the combination of their aesthetics to make, like, a sort of new aesthetic, like, you know, Roman's water background and Amber's light healing powers combining to have a very woodsy or natural aesthetic. And in this case, Blaze, I wanted to combine, of course, Amber's light powers again, and Patrick's fiery attitude, and basically where he came from on Scoria, which is a very hot place. Combine the two, I just wanted to make a blazing fire, hence the name, so a very bright, shining fire. And so I just gave him straight up fire hair. And so this is a trend that you'll see with my fusions that I probably should have mentioned on the other ones, but I guess I'll mention it now, is that, for example, Blaze here. If you have somebody from Scoria, like Patrick is from the planet Scoria. Amber is from the planet Illyrios. So if you have a Scorian, somebody from Scoria, and an Illyrian, somebody from Illyrios, if they fuse together, all of them will have the same attributes as Blaze here. So any person on Scoria fusing with anybody on Illyrios, they would have flaming hair, the same eye placement, the same arm placement, a general sort of fire aesthetic. Trying to get this point across here, sometimes people don't understand it, but once I can do other fusions, I can make the comparisons better. That won't be in this video, but I will say that eventually other Scorians will appear in the story, and so you get to see some sort of variety in fusion. So it's like, it's kind of cool because you get to see different versions of sort of like the same fusion. I wouldn't say the same fusion because it's not another Blaze, but hopefully you get what I mean, and of course it'll be clarified in future videos. I can't stop rambling or this video is going to go on forever, but I guess I'll just wrap it up by saying that, yeah, Blaze is very, very reckless. Another fusion where Patrick's sort of bombastic attitude sort of takes over, and because it kind of gets that way because Amber is also very, like, my way or the highway and very street smart, so the combination of the two just creates a very headstrong and very bombastic fusion. And then also, I should probably say that this is one of my favorite fusion weapons. Although it doesn't really show, like, a lot of the aspects of Patrick's sword, this flaming crossbow is just one of my favorite fusion weapons, along with, like, Leo's axe. Because I just imagine not only them using it as a crossbow, but I imagine they could also, like, change it to be, like, a grappling hook and, like, hold it in their hand, shoot it, and then swing somewhere. I really want to draw that one day, actually. That'd be pretty cool. But yeah, so that's Blaze. Alrighty, so some of you may have been asking up to this point, is it possible for three characters to fuse? Or more? Well, for now, I can assure you that it is possible for three characters to fuse together. Yes, as you can see right here, the main trio of characters fuse together to make Prismera, as you can see here. So you might be asking also, why are they, like, basically completely grayscale? That's a big thing that I want to talk about, because in my previous video, I focused a lot on color, and I said that color was important to my story. That is really exemplified in these fusions. So I'll go back to Leo real quick. Leo is obviously, well, I should first start by saying that my main trio of characters are obviously the primary colors, red, yellow, blue. So, well, some people say that's not the case. Some people say that there are other primary colors, but those are the ones that I'm going with at least. And so, obviously, the red and the blue of Patrick and Roman make the purple Leo. And then the blue and the yellow of, Roman and Amber make the green sky. And the red and of Patrick and the yellow of Amber make the orange blaze. So when it came time for me to make this triple fusion of Prismara, I was like, okay, what do I do with the color palette? Do I just try to mix the colors and see whatever gross brown color it comes out with? Do I make them completely like really dark and like almost completely black? Do I make them only completely white? I really didn't know what to do with it. Experimented with a few designs, and then I just decided to sort of go along with both and have them just be completely grayscale, as if they did have color, like a certain color palette, but all the color was just sort of drained out. And this also reflects sort of their name and sort of their aesthetic with the triangle on their stomach. So eventually, my main trio of characters gain a triangle insignia, which is a right side up triangle with circles on each of the points of the triangle. That's sort of their symbol. Each point refers to each one of the characters and their color, respectively. And so, that triangle also represents a prism. A prism refracts white light, so basically, white light shines into it, and then it comes out in all the colors of the rainbow, which obviously reflects my, main trio characters, their fusions, and then the final fusion, because all the colors combine to make white light, and that's basically what you're seeing when you shine light through a prism. So that's sort of, the general aesthetic of Prismara, and it's something that I'm really proud of. Like, I really like the way Prismara came across. Prismara was on the verge of suffering with that same thing that I was talking about, like their just body type being like too average. So I think the addition of like six arms and like the second mouth on like the head, as you can see, and them being like really odd skin tone, like being completely white slash black, I thought, that was enough to sort of differentiate it and not make it like too average, if you know what I mean. And so I wanted to include the primary colors of the main trio only where it was like tasteful. So they're completely grayscale other than like the symbol in their chest, so, to reference back to, who makes them up. And then also, as you can see, like their photon laser beam thing, which is what I'll talk about. That's another important thing I should mention. Prismara, although, my main three characters are, they get along very well. They're really good friends. Like they really don't have any problems with each other. I mean, they get mad at each other, but I mean, who doesn't get mad at your friends every once in a while? So that's not really important though. What I'm trying to say though is that just because they get along doesn't mean the fusion is going to be stable. Because there are so many minds bouncing around and trying to make coherent thoughts, Prismara cannot form their own weapon. So they don't have a weapon, but sort of an extrapolation of Leo's sort of lava breath and Blaze's flaming hair and Sky's light powers, being able to form those little balls of light that they shoot out of their slingshot, combine all those sort of aspects, and Prismara can basically open up their top mouth, as you can see there, and then basically just spit out a photon laser beam thing that can, like, basically disintegrate matter. Well, to be honest, that may be OP. So that is very subject to change in the future, so I wouldn't, stick with that. I may change that in the future. But I thought having it mostly white, but if you look at it closely, having like a weird rainbowy prismatic effect. And, I think ever if I could, like, I always think of like what that would sound like too. I just thought of like, Godzilla's plasma breath or whatever it's called. I forget, there's like a special name for it, but like when Godzilla roars and shoots out his laser beam, something similar to that. But yeah, so Prismara is one of my favorites, if not my favorite triple fusion. I have a few more which you'll see in future videos when I cover more characters, but I really enjoy Prismara. They're one of my favorites. Also, they seem to be a fan favorite. you know, just where I post my art and stuff like that. People seem to like Prismara. And yeah, so Prismara's the big one. I can't think of anything else to say. I'm probably gonna remember something later on, but yeah, I think that's it for my main trio of character and their fusions. But now we get to move on to Cosmo and his fusions with my main trio of characters, which I haven't fully completed, but I'll be able to show off the ones I have so far. Alright, hopefully I can wrap this up more quickly, because I think these fusions I can sort of go through rapid fire, because there's not much to really talk about them. Sadly, that's because Cosmo is a relatively newer character, even though he's so integral to the plot now. But, so that's sort of the reason why I don't have as many fusions with him, and also, you know, why I don't have really too much to say about them. But first we're going to start off with Anemone here. So, I really didn't know what to do with a lot of Cosmo's fusions, because he's so different, and he's such a particular and specifically, you know, designed character. Like, an axolotl, like, a lot of people don't even know what an axolotl is, so I was like, how do I, you know, combine that with my other characters? And so I was like, okay, he's kind of, like, reptile-ish, amphibious-ish. And then, you know, so is Roman, because this whole thing is like the, you know, turtle shell and stuff like that. Another aquatic character. And they are from the same planet, so I imagine this fusion would be a lot more stable, because I imagine even though they're different species, because they're from the same planet, they would still sort of be an above average stable fusion. So, a lot of fun that I also had with this fusion was basically their tail, because I thought that giving Cosmo a tail would be really fun to sort of extrapolate into fusions and sort of do cool things with that with fusions. So as you can see with Anemone here, they have a large hand tail, and little frills on the back were inspired by a blue iguana. So there's a lot of elements in here that are actually inspired by blue iguana, because they all have these little like frills on them, and then also these big like circular scales at the corner of like their jawline. And so as you can see on Anemone's face, they have little circles on like the jaw cheek area. And so I thought that was just a fun little thing to experiment with. I don't know why my mind went to blue iguana, but I was like, amphibians, reptiles, and they're in the same family. They're close. I know they're two different, like, what's the term, phylums or whatever, but I don't know. I thought it was a cool thing to sort of draw inspiration from. I realize they're kind of goofy with their stomach hanging out, but Cosmo's, he's kind of big, so he kind of makes for some awkward fusions, but I thought the hand tail was cool. It's a you know, sort of a more interesting idea than just adding another set of hands somewhere. I don't know why there's just one. I was gonna go with two on either side and make it look like sort of like a dolphin tail almost, or a whale or whatever, but I don't know. I like Anemone because they're weird and you don't quite understand them. They almost have a little like butlerish quality with the little vest and the little sleeves and stuff. And the poofy pants, I don't know. I just think Anemone's cute. I don't know. To this day, I still can't quite point out or pin down exactly what I like about him. But yeah, that's Anemone. I should also probably mention that a lot of Cosmo's fusions are very, very stable. Like, I mentioned that, you know, Cosmo and Roman's fusion is stable because they're from the same planet, and I think fusions that are of two people from the same planet would be more stable. Not only that, but like I said earlier, Cosmo is a very, very nice person. He gets along with almost everybody, and that really comes across in his fusions. They're very stable, and what I mean by stable is basically they can stay together for long, and they aren't uncoordinated like a lot of fusions. They can basically be their own thing, basically. It's hard to even consider them a fusion if they're very, very stable. But fusions can also be very, very unstable, as you'll see when I start introducing some villains. But Anyway, yeah, so this is Teo. Teo is the fusion of Patrick and Cosmo. And so basically, I got the name Teo from Teoism, which is, I don't want to, you know, like, butcher the meaning of this. I don't even know if it's a religion? It's not a religion. I think it's just like a way of life. I should have researched this beforehand. Look up Teoism. It relates to their chill and relaxed personality. I should have done some more research on that before I started recording this, but oh well. But yeah, so basically, this fusion is very chill. Cosmo's very laid-back attitude sort of takes a hold of Patrick in that sense, because Patrick basically has two modes. He's either, like, absolutely flipping out and is all over the place and can't handle himself and is going nuts, or he's, like, passed out in just, like, a fugue state, sitting there, like, saying nothing, doing nothing. He goes from one extreme to another, and so, obviously, with Cosmo being a very chill guy, just kind of sitting around most of the day, like, even in his official artwork here, he's just sitting down. That sort of side of Cosmo sort of pulls Patrick in that direction, which makes Teo a very chill fusion. Like Anemone, it kind of suffers from the same awkwardness that Cosmo sort of induces in these fusions, because he's a very big guy, so it's kind of weird. But being that, you know, Patrick is sort of a big guy himself, it's weird. It's weird. A lot of Cosmo's fusions are weird. But yeah, so basically that's Teo, and I also wanted to have some sort of aquatic aspect sort of put into this fusion here. So as you can see here, as I already explained, basically Cosmo is an axolotl. And then if you remember back in my last video, when I showed off Patrick's mermaid that I drew, I chose a tiger shark for him. So I was like, okay, well, if I'm picking sort of, you know, another aquatic aesthetic for this fusion, maybe I should give them, like, tiger-like stripes or something like that. So that's where Teo sort of gets his stripes from, as you can see. And basically, like, all of Cosmo's fusions are going to have, like, some sort of body markings or patterns because of those, like, white specklings and shiny bits that Cosmo has on himself. And then also, I chose the stripes because if you look closely, I know it's probably kind of hard to see in the video, but Patrick has a scar across his eye, which is a story for another day. But yeah, so that's basically sort of all the things that are sort of combined to get the aesthetic that I wanted for Teo. And now we are moving on to our second triple character fusion. I think this is probably my least favorite triple fusion that I've made, because I think it suffers from what I was talking about earlier, where these sort of extreme ends of body types sort of even out to make a very average-looking person. The purple skin kind of moves it away from that and kind of makes it a bit more interesting, and I added, like, the body patterning that I was talking about earlier. But this fusion, Mako, which is a fusion of Roman, Patrick, and Cosmo, is another sort of aquatic-based fusion. I gave it that sort of dolphin, fish, whale, whatever you call it, tail. Mako is actually the name of a certain type of shark. I forget where they're from or where they're native to, I should say, but again, more research I should have done before recording this audio. But yeah, so Mako I really didn't know what to do with. A lot of Cosmo's fusions are difficult because the whole axolotl aesthetic that Cosmo has is hard to, you know, sort of combine with other characters. But I was like, okay, what if I make him sort of like push that aquatic aesthetic even more and make him sort of Hawaiian, Polynesian, almost pirate-ish. Like, I think that pirate aesthetic comes off in, like, the striped pants and, like, the little, not tank top thing, but the little, whatever he's wearing, whatever you'd call that thing that he's wearing on his torso, and, like, the little shoulder pad has, like, the hibiscus flowers, like, those Polynesian flowers, and then, of course, the aquatic tail. But again, there's not much to say about Mako because he's not one of my favorites. He's very large. He's bigger than Prismara. I don't know. I don't really know what else to say, but I mean, he's chill, I guess. I don't really know what else to say with him, and I'm probably forgetting some stuff, but yeah, I guess I should just move on to our last final fusion. Alright, so we've reached the last fusion of this video. I've done plenty more, and they'll all have to be covered in future videos, but right now we're just going to talk about, I think you pronounce it abalone? You'd think I'd know how to pronounce my own character's name, but basically abalone or abalone is basically like the stuff that pearls are made out of, or the shiny stuff that you find inside of clams or oysters. So another aquatic aesthetic that I was trying to, you know, get for this fusion. It's abalone or abalone. I call her or them abalone because abalone just sounds like baloney. So I decided to go with the former. But abalone is a another fan favorite fusion. I don't know what it is, but I sort of circumvented the awkwardness that a lot of other of Cosmos fusion sort of suffer with. I really like the way this fusion came out, even though that they have a more human skin tone. I still think whatever it is sort of separates them from the others, and for whatever reason it doesn't suffer from the same problem that I think like Sky suffers from. I think a lot of Amber's fusions can be a bit too average. So recently I've been trying to push her light and healing powers and really make that an aesthetic in the fusion. This is not the case here in this fusion, but I still think it came out well. I wanted to put little like jewels on there and stuff, since Amber has the little necklace and Cosmo has a whole bunch of like little jewels all over him, which of course reflects how he lives in the crystal caves, and a lot of his culture is centered around these crystals and stuff. Basically, I should also mention, you're probably also questioning why none of Cosmo's fusions have weapons, or even Cosmo himself have weapons, because all of my other characters and fusions have so far. Basically, I just thought that Cosmo would be... I don't want to say a pacifist, because he's not a pacifist, but I imagine he thinks that fusion and, you know... I think he believes that fusion is the only weapon that you really need. I think he believes that, you know, if you have a good enough relationship with somebody, you can make a stable enough fusion, and that's all the defense you'll ever need. And that's why he doesn't have a weapon. So he's not a pacifist, I wouldn't say, but he doesn't see the need for, you know, something else to help you out. He thinks being a fusion is enough. So that's why he doesn't have a weapon. And then how that sort of translates into his fusions is I think that the fusions would just be able to wield the weapons of, you know, anybody else. Oh my god, that's a roach. Oh. One roach death later, and just like that, I'm back. Okay, anyway, so about abalone, before I wrap things up. Basically, I don't know what it is about this fusion, but I think just sort of the aesthetic I sort of nailed, and it really feels, I think abalone just really feels like a genuine combination of the two characters. I think what makes a good fusion is being able to tell exactly who, like, what characters make up the fusion, but also, you know, making them seem very separate and making them seem like their own thing, and that they could exist on their own as their own character. And to be honest, I think I nailed that with abalone. I've drawn abalone a few times, and I think I really nailed the design too. She doesn't really look like battle ready, I would say, like they're just wearing like normal clothes, but I think for what they are, I think it's a really well-rounded fusion, and yeah, it's one of my favorites, and it's also a fan favorite. So yeah, I think that's about it for abalone. Yeah, I think that's about it now, and now I'm just gonna wrap it up. Alright, so now that we've reached the end of the episode, I just want to say that I hope you sort of understand now the importance of fusion in my story. I hope you understand the importance of Cosmo and how, you know, his relation to the story. I'm saying I hope you understand the importance, but then again, you haven't really seen or heard any of the story. But basically, the point we're trying to get across is that fusion will be a very integral, or is a very integral part of my story. The fusions mean something and reflect sort of the relationship between the characters. Fusions themselves are basically a manifestation of the character's relationship and suffer when those relationships are suffering, and thrive when those relationships are thriving. Basically, I hope that, you know, sums things up about fusion. I basically just follow Steven Universe rules, like I said, so if you're familiar with that, you know what this is about. Of course, my characters aren't gems, but they fuse anyway. And I think that allows for actually a really wider range of opportunities when designing these fusions. So I should say expect a lot more fusions. I think at this point I have like double the amount of fusions than I have actual non-fusion characters. So yeah, expect more of those, but also expect more characters. I think my next video will just be characters. I'm not sure. Depends on how long it takes me to get to the characters themselves. I might touch on some of their fusions afterwards. It's just because one of the characters in that video would be just very integral, and I believe my oldest character within the canon, and the oldest in terms of how long ago I created him. So yeah, there's a lot to talk about in the next video. There was a lot to talk about in this video. I was hoping to make this video shorter than the last one. I did, but by a very slim margin, so I'd like to apologize for making you sit here for a good hour again. So basically, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any questions about, you know, Cosmo, the fusions, anything relating to this video, or even the last video, just please leave them in the comments. I'd be more than happy to answer them. I don't script these episodes, I don't do a lot of that, and also I'm very new to making videos, so I tend to forget to say things, I tend to ramble, I tend to slur over my words, so if you didn't understand something, I would love to clarify in the comments. I'm making these to explain my story, and if my point didn't get across because I, you know, went off on a weird tangent, just please let me know. I'm open to critique. Anything you want to say in the comments to help me out, or if you want, you know, are curious about anything or have any questions, feel free. That's enough of that. Again, I hope you enjoyed. Please consider subscribing for more of this. Probably more Disney content in the near future. I don't really like to say that this channel is going to go in a specific way. I know it's going to be focused on art, but I want to keep this open. And I want to, you know, allow this to be a place for me to just post kind of whatever I want. So I'll just leave it at that. Definitely expect more art. I hope you enjoyed. And yeah, I guess I'll see you either in the next video, or in the next video in the series, or just, you know, whatever else I upload. I might upload like a time-lapse painting between then and now. So I hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!